Hello.
That looked a bit fascist, that. Better not do that.
No, we can't do that anymore.
We'll do a little... What do you mean, anymore? Well, remember, you're allowed to do it.
Well, you weren't meant to do it in the first place, but...
No.
No.
We were just waving.
So, hello.
Christ almighty, we're already in the in hot water.
Yes, well...
We just started.
We live on the edge, we live on the edge. So, here we are with Will. William Alfred Sargent, and he's kindly invited us into his home and to discuss the first four albums, which have just been re-released on 180 gram vinyl, if that means something to people. So, well, what's the difference with vinyl weight?
It's just thicker, so the grooves can be deeper and the sound can be better. And it's been remastered. They've all been remastered from the original tapes.
Right.
So it's as pure sound as you can get on vinyl. Ooh. You know, nice.
It's like having you in the front room then.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, okay, so before we get into discussing the albums in a bit more detail, I just wanted to give you few little facts. You know, in total, Crocodiles, Heaven Up Here, Porcupine and Ocean Rain has spent over a year in the UK charts. It, to be exact, it's been a total 65 weeks those albums have been in the chart, which nowadays that's unheard of. You know, and I suppose you got to also remember back in the day, don't keep like saying that, but lots of units would have been sold as well, wouldn't they? Yeah. So I think did Porcupine?
No, there wasn't that many units.
No, so. Porcupine did over 100,000.
Yeah, but you know.
That's pretty good.
It's not compared to a lot of people. But yeah, it's good. It's better than a kick in the
teeth. Well, not compared to Adele.
Yeah.
But, you know, but she's unique, shall we say. And then the four albums have influenced some of the biggest names in music. Just to name a few: Radiohead, The Cure, U2, Nirvana, and even the Coldplay for the modern music fan. So, yeah. And
Courtney Love told me that Nirvana were going to do Back of Love on that Unplugged.
But oh,
then,
right.
Then they went with, in the end they went with Man Who Sold the World.
Never mind. So. And it must seem mad to yourself, you know, if you think when those albums were released about 40 years ago, that they're now being re-released on vinyl, on heavier vinyl, and the sleeves are thicker.
Well, the way I look at it, it's like, you know, in the 80s, I wasn't listening to, you know, 1940s dance bands. You know what I mean? Like, I kind of like it, you know, but it wasn't like, obsessed with it. It's weird the way that pop music has got the longevity and kind of it has become kind of a staple of culture somehow.
Well, that's what you always wanted though, wasn't it?
That, yeah.
You know, that status, you know.
Well, I just wanted us to be seen as a classic band and like made good records, you know, and weren't a fad. We're kind of real, you know, and I think we are. We're real.
Well, yeah. I think you've definitely achieved that. So, without further ado, I'm going to reach down and get my Echo and the Bunnymen carrier bag out, available from all government retailers. And first one we're going to pick out is this little beauty, Crocodiles. So, released 18th of July 1980, recorded in Rockfield and Eden Studios. Chart position of number 17 it reached, and it was in the charts for 6 weeks. And I'm going to read a little review out here. Rolling Stone magazine gave Crocodiles 4 stars, saying the chilling acoustic fragility of the band's original versions of Pictures on My Wall and Red It in Books has since been joined by the nervous Birds/Talking Head style jangle of Ian McCulloch's and Will Sargent's electric guitars and brittle snap of Pete DeFratis's drumming. And it's exactly this unnerving contrast between the colliding guitars, and McCulloch's tortured yelp that gives Crocodiles its dramatic impetus. That's pretty good, isn't it?
Yeah, it's great.
So, Will,
right,
tell me about the cover and the inner sleeve.
Right, on okay. this. Well, the inner sleeve, the picture there, that was because of... Hold on, I've got it here somewhere. Because of... Hold on, is it in here? Yeah, because of that.
Ah, right, okay.
Like, I like that. And the fact that we all got Fender amps and everything was from this... Ultimate Classic, Marky Moon, and that's why, you know, I wanted, well, you know, Aunt Bill and everybody wanted a picture of us on the inside, and that was kind of inspired by television. The cover, we went to this woods where they do, they make TV shows there. It was kind of like a sort of little farm that they made TV shows, you know.
Right.
And I remember, I think it was, was it called Black? No. Might have been
Black Beauty.
No, it wasn't Black Beauty. They might have done that there, but there was there was a thing called Dick Turpin or
with what was he called, Dave?
Yeah, it was him.
On ITV.
Richard O'Sullivan.
Yeah,
and so just behind that, like over there, like that way, there was you'd see like the odd carriage going past with, you know, kind of horse drawn carriage and like some sort of Dick Turpin-esque kind of shenanigans going on. But we were waiting for it to go dark because Brian Griffin, who took the photo, had organised 50,000 watts of spotlights and, you know, lighting, different colours. So, you know,
yeah,
we waited for it to go dark. And the best thing about it was when we were going, when we'd finished it, the covers, we took quite a few photos. And when we finished it, we were in the van and we were going down this little sort of bumpy cart track to get to the road, and you look back and it was all misty, and there was like this little copse of woods and all the lights were coming out of the top, and it looked amazing. It looked like, you know, Close Encounters of the Third Kind, even though that hadn't been done by then. And it was brilliant. You know, it was cold, it was a bit cold, I remember that, and we were quite close to a canal. There was a canal sort of there, I don't know which canal it was. It was on the outskirts of London somewhere.
Right. Yeah. I don't know, for some reason I always thought it was up north, either in Lancashire or Merseyside.
No, it was down south. And because Brian knew about this farm that you could hire, you know, and they were obviously hiring it for TV shows.
Yeah,
stuff like that, so.
So.
And I look a bit cheesed off there, don't I?
Well, that...
Nothing's changed.
That brings me nicely... to Cream magazine gave a review of the album cover, and they said the cover art suggests four boys dazed and confused in a drugged dream, a surreal where are we landscape.
Oh yeah,
the Bunnymen's images are of loneliness, disconnection and a world gone awry. That's And is it true?
No, the only drug I'd had at that stage was paracetamol.
So, was it true that you were considering putting burning stakes?
Yeah.
In the trees?
No, that was another idea. We were going to have, like, sort of stakes and flames and stuff, but it just seemed a bit stupid.
Yeah.
And so the lights took on the job of the flameage. And, you know, it's great.
Yeah.
Classic, but we always thought that looked like a bunny rabbit. This bit here, with Les putting his hand through there, we thought that looked like a bunny rabbit's head.
Ah, right, okay.
Look at it.
You sure it's just paracetamol?
So,
fantastic. So, memories of recording that album?
Rockfield, well, Eden first with Ian Brodie producing, and he did Rescue and Pride. He didn't want to do the whole album. He just wanted to do a single or whatever.
Right.
And that was fine. We went into this studio called Rockfield, which was in Wales. And it was a farm, another farm. It's a working farm, but they had like all the, some of the stables and things like that have been turned into studios, and it was great. It was it was like, you know, I'd never been anywhere or done anything. We'd done a few gigs up and down the country, but to go into a studio where they looked after you like you're a minor god, you know, it was great. You don't realise at the time that you're actually paying for everything. Eventually it's going to go on a bill. But you just, you know, because we do things like we'd hire in guitars and leave them there for like 3 weeks, just nobody playing them.
Yeah,
just,
yeah, but still then, paying for
yeah,
them.
Yeah, yeah, and like stupid things like that, you know, where you didn't, because we were so naive about it all, we didn't really understand how it all worked. But it was fantastic. I loved Rockfield, you know. And they did a documentary about it not long back, and I was a little bit cheesed off that we didn't get much of a mention.
Right,
we were
okay.
There a lot, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
I remember there one time, Jimmy, Robert Plant was there, and he took us into town in his car. And another time, Ginger Breaker, we went to the pub with him. It was good. It was kind of, you know, interesting people there.
Yeah,
about,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah, oh, fantastic. Is it still going, Rockfield?
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so as a fan, you know, because that's what I am, of the band, for me, my favourite track from Crocodiles, it's Crocodiles. It's track Crocodiles.
Yeah.
Maybe a bit of a controversial choice, I don't know, but I just think Pete's drumming on it. It's just manic, and you can really feel him hitting the skins really, really hard. And it's just, you know, it's just this really full-on song. And at the end, when it just finishes, it's kind of,
yeah,
there we go, we've done it. But so what would you say was your favourite track off it, and why?
Oh, God. Probably Going Up. I like the sort of trippiness of it, you know, and it's kind of changes halfway through, and...
Yeah.
I like things like that where, like, you know, it starts off doing one thing and then ends up doing another.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
But, you know, I like when I was doing Crocodiles, you know, the guitar bits, I was stood on top of an amplifier. It was a Fender Twin Reverb, and I had my Telecaster, and I was kind of trying to channel Wilco Johnson.
Right.
You know, I was kind of, like, I remember, like, I cut my fingers to bits. There's all blood all over the guitar. That's why Wilco Johnson has a red scratch plate.
Ah, okay.
But I, you know, mine was, I think it was black. But anyway, it was blood everywhere.
Right.
And it was just what you had to do, you know.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay, so that's Crocodiles. So make sure in the comments, it's a little bit far from me, put in the comments, you know, what's your favourite track?
Can we put it on air so it's on air as well? Is that possible?
It might be. That would be like watching you, watching me, watching you, watching me. So, but anyway, so let me get the next one while Will just messes around with the internet down there. And out of the magic bag, we have... heaven up here.
Oh, hold on.
So we need to.
What colour's that? Light blue or dark blue?
Light blue. So, there we go. Technology. So, heaven up here. Let me get my notes.
Damage your cover there.
Sorry, no. I think it was a price sticker, maybe one of those big Warner stickers. Yeah. Hold on. You're too keen. Okay, released 30th of May 1981. Recorded at Rockfield Studios again. UK chart position of number 17, and in the charts for 10 weeks, 4 months is in the charts. That's bonkers. Anyway, not 4 months, 10 weeks, but which is amazing. Rolling Stone magazine has ranked Heaven Up Here as one of the top 500 albums of all time. Mojo gave it 5 stars, Record Mirror gave it 5 stars, and The Guardian gave it 5 stars. In 1982, in an interview in 1982 with the band for NME, rock journalist Barney Hoskins described the album as one of the most superior articulations of rock form in living memory. So again, same format as we did with Crocodiles. Tell me about the sleeve and the inner sleeve.
Well, we were at Rockfield again, and we were recording the album.
Right.
And we were going to go on a tour to America, and we were getting ready for a tour and recording the album, and we needed to do the cover.
Right.
So they took us. Brian Griffin came up, and we went down to what was the place? Did it say where it was? Somewhere in Wales.
Yeah, the beach in Wales.
I can't remember where it was, but we just got in the car and we went down the beach. The other thing we had to do as well is we had to do passport photos the same time.
To go to Wales?
No, because we were going to America. We had to get our visa thing, so we had to go to one of them photo booth things and get our passport photos as well. I don't know if that was the same day as the photo, but I seem to remember going to, somewhere in Wales, I don't know where. And what we did was we threw... Brian Griffin turned up with a great big bag of whitebait, which is like little fish, sprats, little tiny fish. And he threw them all out, out there, so all the seagulls had come and... See, the seagulls... They all came and, that's how we got so many seagulls on the picture, because we threw all these little fish there,
Right.
And then we had to stand
there.
That's
a good idea.
Yeah, yeah. And that's how we did that. And it is a classic photo, isn't it?
It
so
is. Amazing. I mean, the shadows are amazing. The
reflections.
Yeah. So is it true, I've got here, that both Bill Drummond and Rob Dickens, who's head of Carovan, I don't know if he was head of Warners at the time, hated the picture from the shoot, and that Brian had to fight for them to be used on the sleeve. And then after that, the cover received the Best Dressed LP Award at the 1981 NME.
Yeah, Awards. Well, we had a lot of arguments with the record label and that, so that doesn't... I didn't know that, but I wouldn't surprise me.
Right.
He probably wanted us all with our faces on the... It'll be because we're facing away from the camera, They like everything dead obvious, don't they? I think we wanted the writing smaller, but they wouldn't let us have it smaller.
Right.
That sort of stuff. Like, if it was up to me, I wouldn't have any writing on it at all.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't think it matters. I think people that like records know what the script is. Like Led Zeppelin 4 hasn't got any writing on the cover.
Yeah, yeah.
It'd ruin it.
So I think it wasn't until the Grey album, when that first came out, that didn't have any writing on the cover, but then I think they repressed it with writing on it.
Oh, did they?
Afterwards, yes.
Right.
Yeah, so if you got one of the Grey album without the writing on the front, you got one of the first pressings.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Well, the first pressings of this had like a texture on the cover.
Yeah, which I didn't find out until...
And the other thing, I remember... We got the records, and we went to a shop. It was like a TV shop or something, and said, "Can we just play this record? We want to listen to something," because there was a mix that we didn't want on it. There was something wrong with the mix. I can't even remember now. It was probably something really minor. Everything used to get on. If there was like one little thing that was wrong, we used to get really upset over it. Yeah, and it was the wrong mix on the record. Like, I can't even remember which track it was now, but... And when we moaned to the record label, they said, "It's all right, we're gonna send all them to France." So there is, like, slightly different versions, apparently. I don't know. I can't even remember what it was, but it was something... Probably something really pathetic, like the tambourine wasn't loud enough or something like that. Much cowbell.
So memories of recording it? It must have been a good
amazing.
Time, wasn't it?
Oh, it was amazing, because we'd moved from, like, the studio at Rockfield, it's like a farmyard.
Yeah.
And then they had, like, these chalets around, but right by the studios. But then they also had a house that was on this hill.
Right.
And we were in the house on the hill for that recording. So we'd have to come down this hill, and all the time, Les had run ahead and hide in the bushes. And it was pitch black, there was no lights anywhere. So we'd be coming down this track, and like, he jumped out at us and like pretended he was a wild dog or something, and like biting our ankles, like, and we shit ourselves. But then he did it every time we went down the studio when it was night time then. And he didn't have to hide in the bushes anymore because he knew that we'd be like terrified going down, like going down this hill, expecting him to jump out any minute. You know, it was psychological warfare.
Yeah, yeah.
But it worked. And it was great. It was the dead inventive time. Like Hugh Jones, who produced it, was, you know, he did like some of the stuff on Crocodiles as well. And he was, he had like a vast knowledge of music and how it all worked. And we were new to it, you know, like we were learning all the time. So it was kind of a really good learning curve. And he brought in this bloke, what's his name? Penny something. Is it on here somewhere? Be on here somewhere. There we go. Woodwind, Leslie Penny. He brought this bloke in that he knew, and he came with a load of recorders.
Right.
Like, who'd have thought, you know, a rock band wants a recorder on the record. And he had all these different sized recorders, and he was like an expert at recorders. And he played on Zimbo, and he did this record, and he could do this thing where he could bend the note, you know, like slide across the... Right. Like they have little holes, don't they?
Yeah.
If you can slide across the hole, you can kind of like...
Make like a warble
kind of bend the note. And that's how he did that thing in, Zimbo, you know, All My Colours.
Wow.
And, I remember him being there, and he had all these boxes full of like old fancy posh records. They weren't like the school ones. They were like,
the large wooden ones.
Yeah, like big ones and all different sizes and quality recorders.
Quality recorders, no plastic ones then.
No.
So, for me as a fan, it was very hard for me to pick my favourite track off Heaven Up Here.
Yeah.
You know, because you've got Rescue, Turquoise Days.
Rescue's not on it. Rescue's on Crocodiles.
Hold on. Start that again. Favourite track, Turquoise Days and Zimbo. But for me, it had to be No Dark Things.
Oh, right,
it's my favourite because of Les's bass.
Yeah.
Your guitar, not saying it because you sat next to me, sounded really, you know, sort of real choppy and wild. But yeah, so for me, it would be No Dark Things.
Yeah.
What about for you?
It's a difficult one, isn't it? Because they've all got their own little thing going on, you know? I don't know. Like, I really like Show of Strength. I like, you know, that it's got like quite a few different parts to it. But Over the Wall as well. I love playing Over the Wall. I love playing it live. But then I was listening to Turquoise Days because somebody posted a video and I put that up on my Facebook before, you know, and it was from some Belgian TV show. And it was, like, I've seen it before loads of times, I think, but it was just...
Yeah.
Look so good, and I was like, I look like I'm doing, you know, kind of, you know, that robot dance. Looks a bit like that, you know. I don't know what I was doing. What was I thinking? Anyway, it's kind of like, you know, we were trying to be like, I don't know, robots, or I was, you know, I don't know what we're trying to do. But it's a great, it's like Turquoise Days is great. But yeah, probably Over the Wall if I had to choose.
Okay, okay. It's a good one to choose.
Yeah.
It is a good one to choose. Okay, so again, in the comments, please put which is your favourite track from Heaven Up Here and why. You know, so you need to justify it. So can you read those there?
No.
No.
Hold on.
Have you got... Perfect. Can you read those now? Well, I...
No, it's too close. These binoculars are too good.
So, Will, do you want to...
Shall we show them that? That meant a lot to us at the time, 77. And obviously...
Ramones?
Yeah. And one of my personal favourites... was these, Pere Ubu. And that's, I just love this record, you know, from Cleveland.
Did play Eric's?
Yeah, saw them at Eric's, and they were brilliant. And, what's I got here? Oh yeah, obviously.
Iggy?
Iggy Pop, The Idiot, that was a big record. And one of my personal favourites here is Roxy Music. I've got six copies of this, six different copies. I think I need some sort of medication.
So, you've got to do something well.
Oh shit, yeah, what are we on now? Oh, white.
We're on crocodiles. Oh, sorry, porcupine.
It's gone blue, it hasn't gone white, has it?
No, it's gone blue on there. It's gone white here.
Yeah. You
know? It's a bit hard to explain, but that'll do. That's close enough. Okay, so I'll just read the details out. So, released on the 4th of February 1983, but recorded in 1982. Trident Studios, Rockfield again, yeah. And Amazon Studios. UK chart position of number 2 in the charts for 17 weeks. Rolling Stone magazine album guide gave it 4 stars. The Guardian gave it 4 stars. A review said, Porcupine is front-loaded with its 2 key singles, The Startling, The Cutter, and the strangely grand, The Back of Love. Both songs benefit from the dramatic string playing of Shankar, who also lands who lends an ominous drone to Heads Will Roll.
Yeah.
Okay, well, same format again. Tell me about the cover and the inner sleeve.
Well, we got into this idea that we wanted like naturalistic covers. So we'd done like the beach and we'd done the woods. And, you know, the next thing was like snow. But Bill Drummond had been to Iceland years ago when he was a kid. He went on an Icelandic fishing boat, worked his passage to Iceland as an Icelandic. You know, he's mental, isn't he? He's like, you know, oh, I want to go to Iceland. How can I get there? I want a fishing boat.
Right.
Like,
probably one of the hard fishing boats are hard, but an Icelandic one. It's tough.
So, and we went over there, and I think Brian and his assistant and Martin Atkins, who did the designing and the lettering and everything, they scouted around and they heard about this place, Gullfoss, Golden Falls, in Iceland near Reykjavik. And we got these two Mitsubishi 4-wheel drive vehicles. We got up about 3 o'clock in the morning and then we headed off across the tundra. And it wasn't all roads, some of it was actually across like snow and stuff. And we got there and we got this place and it was just like amazing. It was, you know, blew your mind. And Brian goes, just get down there and we'll take the photo. And like this bit here, this is like a little ledge. It looks about 6 foot wide or something. And we're all shoving each other and messing around. And if you look on the back, I'll show you where it is. Like, that's where we were, that ledge there. So down here is a 400 foot drop to certain death. And we were like dicking around, shoving each other and playing about and all that. And it was like, when I came back, I think I had post-traumatic stress disorder. So like, sometimes I'd wake up and think, God, what were we doing? None of us had proper gear on.
You don't look prepared.
Well, I had a parka. Mac had these kind of like little sort of booties. They were soaking wet, you know, feet must have been freezing. But it was great. It was like, there was like a spirit of adventure in the band. It was more than being in a band. We loved the vehicle of the band being able to take us on adventures and go to places that, you know, I'd been to Wales for 3 days and that was the only place I'd ever been, you know. until we went started doing touring in Europe and America and all that, and then it just blew my mind.
So is it true that you also considered Scotland for the album cover, but they didn't choose it because there wasn't enough snow?
I don't know. I've never heard anything of that.
Right, okay.
But it's possible, but, you know, maybe, like, Bill might have thought of that straight. Just to play Belfast when all the bands wouldn't go, you know, when all the troubles were going on. And we always used to go there because Bill Drummond used to go there when he was a kid.
Yeah, but I know for a fact that because you played Belfast during the troubles, that is one of the reasons why you still have such a huge following in Belfast. And, you know, it was really, really appreciated.
Yeah, well, you know, yeah. We just did it. We didn't, like, you know, it was a bit scary at the time, but, you know, whatever.
Yeah, yeah. You told me a fact about this cover earlier, which I've never, ever noticed before.
Yeah, it's a bit difficult to
share with the viewers.
Yeah, okay. But you're not going to be able to see it because, you know, unless this zooms. But if you look on the cover, just about...
You can't find it now.
No, got it there. There. So imagine it's like, you know, 1 o'clock on the cover or something. There's a little blue dot. And that little blue dot is Bill Butt, who was making the video for the cutter. And he's messing around with his cameras. And he's on the cover. You can see him on the cover. Now, I think on some of the later covers, they've cleared it off. I've seen some covers where he's not there.
Tip X'd out.
You've done something, yeah, you know, Photoshop or something. But yeah, he's got a blue. He's got a blue, you can't see it, can you? He's got like a blue puffer jacket on.
Right.
Yeah, he was the only one that had any proper gear because they were all into, Bill and his mates were all into mountaineering and jumping around at the top of mountains and all that lot.
So,
When I look at that now, I just think, God, what were we doing, you know? And you just do it, you know, it's just like, oh yeah, we'll get down there. Brian, no problem.
Push you down. So memories of recording that album. I mean, would I be right in saying, would this be after you and Les had been to Russia? Because it does sound a bit, sort of, some of the strings, you know, the guitar sounds in it do sound a bit sort of.
Well, what year was it recorded?
So it was recorded 1982.
No, we hadn't been to Russia. We went in 1983, Christmas, right. 1983. And I can prove it. Because. I've got. That. Now, this is the paper from Russia from New Year. Oh, 1st of. Well, that says
1984.
Yeah. And what's that? So, and that's been kept by my ex-girlfriend Laura. She kept that. She'd lent it to me to have a look at. And send me a load of other stuff.
That's good.
Dead handy.
You have to get Google Translate on the yeah. on the cover to find out what the news was. So memories of recording the album. So was this the first album that you did?
I remember
did
the
some
cutter
work at Amazon.
Yeah, I know. I think we used to do it on demos and stuff like that. Demo and all that. There was like a little sort of outside kitchen thing, and they'd got in there, and they hadn't actually got into the flat.
Right.
So we were dead lucky because there was loads of stuff worth robbing. And I had to go back and just change it all. And when I came back. Ian, had, you know, Ian Brody had done that, you know, where he goes, spare us the cutter, and he goes, twang.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Well, he'd done them bits.
Right.
So, you know, that's not me, it's him doing them.
Okay.
And so, you know, I had to kind of learn how to do these things that Ian and me and Brody had done.
So on the cutter, the famous noise at the beginning.
That's Shankar.
Right, so what was he using to get that?
Oh, he had this weird double neck violin. I've got the record there. I wish I'd dug it out now, but it'd probably take ages to find it. He had like it was like a frame, and then two necks.
Right.
And it was a little electronic, and it was like bits of perspex and stuff. He had it specially built, And Shankar had been playing since he was 3 years old. So he could do like this kind of weird thing where he could play on one of the necks, like the notes, but he could also drone.
Wow.
On the other neck, he could kind of drag the bow of the violin across the other neck at the same time. So it gives it this like weird Indian drone-y kind of thing going on. And
where did that idea come up with to put that noise at the that sound at the beginning? Because it's so...
I think me and Bill Drummond went to see this bloke called Steve Israel when we'd gone to New York.
Right.
And he was managing this Shankar and he showed us a video of him. And we said, well, I said to Bill, we've got to get him on the record.
Yeah.
And the thing with Bill Drummond was he was so good at organising things. He only had to half suggest something and the next day it'd be organised and he'd be like, you know, like look at the KLF stuff that he's done. He just gets it together, doesn't he? That's his major strength, you know, kind of making the impossible possible. So we got him in and you know, we asked him to play it. Like Ian Brody says he said it, but I remember like me and him, we were really into that song, Matthew and Son.
Right.
Cat Stevens. And I don't know who said it, like really, like it might have been Ian, but we said, can you do something like a psychedelic version of Matthew and Son?
Right, okay.
And then he did that, you know. And then I've got to try and learn it on the bloody guitar.
Yeah.
Keep making a rod from your own back.
So just get a tape.
Yeah. Well, yeah, you could do it, yeah. So, well, you know, Jake used to do it as well.
Yeah, so yeah, he did, so... again, my favourite track on there, first of all, I know a lot of people might disagree with this, I hope they don't, but it's my favourite album out of the four.
Well, it got like, we started it and some of the things that we'd done, the record company didn't like them. They were probably a bit naive or primitive, I don't know, but we had to go in and redo some of the things.
Right.
It was a difficult, you know, it's a difficult third album, if you like, you know.
It's a great, I hope people understand what I mean, but it's a great headphone album. You know, nice and loud in your headphones, because there's so much going on in the background, you always hear something new. And the standout track for me is My White Devil.
Oh, yeah.
Pete's... Is it a marimba he's playing? Like the xylophone?
Yeah.
Kind of.
It's a marimba, I think.
Yeah. So, you know, at the start and then, you know, a marimba solo halfway through it.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it's just fantastic. Yeah. It's absolutely amazing.
Well, that was it. We were into, like, trying different instruments and, you know, it was kids in a candy shop kind of thing.
Yeah,
you know, all of
a
sudden there was this thing called recording and it didn't just have to be guitars. But we wanted everything to be real, you know. We didn't want, you know, like we never really used synthesizers. There's one synthesizer on Over the Wall. There's like a riff thing. Dave Balfe did it. And then there's like some sort of white noise, kind of like a bit like Hawkwind kind of,
stuff.
But that's it. We didn't really, we wanted a weird sound. Or an unusual sound, or something that nobody else had. We did it ourselves. We found something, or Hugh Jones would suggest something, or Ian Brody would suggest something, and we, you know, or we'd record the guitar in a funny way, or you know, we did all kinds of stuff. Like on Crocodiles, there's a screaming solo on Happy Death Man. Did you know that? I do this big mad scream in the middle of Happy Death Man.
Not if I want to know that.
and I did it right down the end of a corridor.
Right.
And the microphone was at the other end. So it has this like ambient kind of weird.
Oh, okay.
You have a listen for it. It's in there, low in the mix.
I'll play it in the car when I'm going back.
Yeah.
So, standout track for you off the album?
I really like Heads Will Roll. You know, I love that Indian kind of vibe on it. And. But, you know, Ripeness is great.
Yeah.
And what's that other one? Higher Hell.
Yeah, yeah.
Higher Hell. Like, you know, I when I'm doing Tim's listening parts, like, I haven't listened to these records for years. Like, I mean, 20-odd years.
Yeah.
And when I did Tim's listening party, I listened to them again, you know, and Porcupine, like, because it was sort of shrouded in, like, problems a little bit, you know. Mm-hmm. Like, I know we did an early version of Heads Will Roll and they didn't like that and they didn't like other things. So we had to do stuff again. But, like, when I listened to it again, I thought it was amazing. I thought it was, like, out there and, you know, it's a psychedelic album, really.
Yeah,
like,
it's amazing.
Yeah, so that's it, really, you know. It was an all in all an amazing adventure. I'm glad we did it. And we nearly died. And we nearly died on the way.
Best adventures you do, don't you?
When we came out of Iceland as well. Because it was like when nobody went to Iceland like they do now. It's kind of like a bit of a destination now.
Yeah,
people go there and, you know, wonder at all the volcanic activity and all that stuff. But then it was just a weird little island that nobody really went to. And there was a tiny airport there at Keflavik, and it was just a shed. It was just literally a shed. And we landed on this Icelandair plane, and that was fine. But then coming home, it was snowing. It was like a blizzard.
Right.
It was a proper blizzard. So the plane kept getting iced up, and they had this truck that would go around the plane spraying this de-icer stuff on it. And it tried to take off three times, and it was too heavy, couldn't get off the ground. So it's like, you know, we're all like strapped in, crapping ourselves, and it's trying to take off, and then it like, and it turns around and goes back again, like, you know. And in the end, they got a rope from the plane to the shed, and they put, and also these vans came and sort of stopped, because it was a proper like 100 mile an hour gale going.
Yeah.
And we had to sort of go back to the shed holding these ropes like this. And then when we got in the shed, like, I think there's a picture of me with headphones on. I'm like really pissed off. And I was listening to a Walkman. They'd just been invented not long back, you know.
I think I know the picture, actually.
Yeah, Brian Griffin was there, and we're all freezing cold. And then the electricity went off in the shed. So it was like, and we had to wait until the blizzard had stopped before they took off. And then, like, the fourth time they tried to do it, it managed to get off. But it was, God.
They don't know.
And I hated flying at the time.
I don't blame you.
And I was really scared, you know. I can remember it. Like, remember everything about it, you know. Going back to the thing and
so I've got a couple of pictures to show you, which I'm gonna have to, we're sort of gonna have to show to the camera to see if you can bring back any memories. So these are, so I've got three pictures. These are original,
the Polaroid test prints.
Pete and Ian having a ciggy break in that one. And great moody one there. You can all see that.
I don't know when this was, though, and I don't know who took the photos.
So,
you know, so I don't know, I don't think it was Brian.
So we've got one, that one of Les in the camo era, by the looks of it.
That's a good one.
Yeah.
That bulletproof vest that he's got on weighed more than his base. It was like, it's got like, it must have had some sort of lead lining in it or something. It was crazy, the weight of it.
He can carry off a headscarf, can't he?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So.
Carry off anything, Les.
Well, he's a strong man. And this one of Pete.
You can't really see him on that, though. It's a bit pointless. I've got better pictures than that. They're rubbish.
Oh, come on. Well, that one, then. Is it you in Paris? Well, no, it's you.
I think it's either Paris or it could be Brussels.
So would that be Ocean Rain time?
If it's Paris, it probably would be. But I don't know.
Yeah.
Difficult to say. Les would know. I think he probably took that one.
So, time to change the light.
Oh, right, okay.
So we're going with
Dark blue.
Yeah, dark blue. Oh, and that's a good match, that one. Yes. So we're going with Ocean Rain. So, still got the old Virgin Records $5.99 sticker on it. Okay. Oh, yeah. So, I'll give you some facts about this. Released the 4th of May, 1984. Studio des Dames, is it?
Yeah.
In Paris. And the also in Bath. Is that right?
Crescent Paris Studios.
Yeah, Paris Crescent Studios in Bath and Amazon Studios.
Yeah.
UK chart position of number 4. It was in the charts for an incredible 26 weeks. Rolling Stone magazine album guide gave it 4 stars. Guardian 4 stars. Record Collector 5 stars. Q magazine recently gave it 4 stars. Music journalist Max Bow said in his 1984 review for the Times newspaper, "This time vocalist Ian McCulloch has tempered his metaphysical songs with a romantic sweetness, and the band's melodies are more to the fore. Acoustic guitars, brushes, and sparingly used keyboards all add to the album's optimistic warmth, and there is a consistency of atmosphere in songs like Seven Seas and Silver." There you go.
Yeah.
So, tell us about the cover in the inner sleeve. Probably one of the most recognisable covers, I'd say.
Well, it was this cave, wasn't it, in Cornwall. I can't ever remember what it's called. It's like some...
I haven't got like that down, because I thought you
would
know.
It's like some sort of fancy Cornish name. But it's actually a slate mine. It wasn't a cave. And the way he'd lit it... there's a thing on YouTube where Brian's talking about it, Brian Griffin... And he's lit it so that there's a dark bit here, so it looks like we've come out of there. But that's just a wall. There's nothing there. The cave doesn't carry on there. But
I didn't know that.
It was very grey in there. You know, it didn't look like that. You know, and he put lights on in there, and it kind of brought it to life.
Uh-huh.
You know, these lights that they had down there. And that's what, of course, created all that blueness. We got in that little boat and, you know, we sort of manoeuvred it into the middle. Les did it. And if you look on the cover, there's a chain hanging down here. See all these little bits here? These are like chains and stuff. If you look at it closely, you can see, like, in fact, you can see them there on the back, dead big. Here. It's like chains and things like that where they... Obviously, the mine workings,
right.
Something, you know, must have been hoists or block and tackle or something. And
is there any significance to how you're all positioned in the boat?
Not by me. Maybe Brian had some sort of thing. I don't know. You know. I don't know.
I'll take that as a no, then.
Well, it's possible. Like, you know, Max at the front, isn't he? The front man.
Yeah.
You know, I'm there, and then there's like Les and Pete at the back providing the sort of the foundation for it all, you know.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
You know, maybe there was. You know, it's a great cover.
It is, it's brilliant.
Like, nobody was doing, I think Brian did one for Depeche Mode, which was really good as well, that one in the field where the girls
broken
got
Broken Frame.
Yeah. That's one of Brian Griffin's covers.
Yeah.
And he's just a genius, isn't he? You know.
He's got a very good book out, actually, Brian Griffin, of his album covers. Yeah.
No, it's well worth checking out, you know, and tracking him down, because I know I think he's got posters of these, or prints or something.
Yeah, he's just released prints for them. So we'll put the link Facebook.
Yeah,
definitely. So, so memories of recording that album. Was it a tricky album or?
On occasion, like, we didn't have all the tracks. We made up Thorn of Crowns. We made that up in the studio. That wasn't quite long enough. We had a lot of the stuff. But
Strange song, Thorn of Crowns.
Well, we were quite into like Bo Diddley at the time. Yeah, that beat, like, you know. It's kind of a Bo Diddley thing. So we just sort of jammed in the studio and goes on a bit. It's probably a bit long, isn't it? You know, but
it's a good one for the get the crowd going.
It used to be great playing it live.
Yeah.
And it's kind of got that sort of Eastern vibe to it as well. Yeah, it was great. You know, Paris. We went to Paris to do it.
So what made you go to Paris? Was it just to have a jolly or?
No, it was Mac wanted to go to Paris, I think. Right. He wanted to go there and, you know, to get like a kind of more romantic kind of vibe to the whole thing, you know, that's what the idea was. And it was brilliant. Me and Les took our push bikes and we go cycling around, you know, the cobbled streets of Paris.
Yeah, yeah.
And, there's some photos that we've got, you know.
Yeah, so you put some up on your Twitter, didn't you?
Yeah. And it was great. And we had a French engineer and a French sort of producer, but we kind of all chipped in on the production side of things. It was kind of, we didn't have any producer really. And Pete could speak French pretty fluently, so that was quite handy, you know, because he'd been to a posh school and everything. And we met a string arranger that had worked with a lot of French, you know, proper French big stars.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know who, you know, I don't know, Charles Aznavour. Yeah, somebody like that. So. And we went out for a meal with him. And me and Mac didn't like him. I thought he was a git, like, you know. So we said, I don't know, I don't like him. We don't want him involved. Like, you know, he was a bit of a, I don't know, we just didn't like him. And we'd done some stuff with Adam Peters.
Uh-huh.
You know, he'd done, a couple of bits and bobs for us, playing cello.
Mm-hmm.
And we got in touch with Adam. We thought of Adam because he was like a proper trained musician.
Yeah.
And he said, yeah, I'm well up for it. And he flew over straight away and started. There was a piano in this little sort of... It was kind of like the room where you went to hang out when you weren't recording or you wanted to get out of the studio for half an hour and have a cup of tea or whatever. And there was a piano there. And we were giving Adam tapes of what we were doing in the studio. Sure. And he was like taking bits from the tapes and transcribing them on the piano and then like writing and think, and, you know, this is going to be a French horn or this is going to be, you know, and he'd explain it to us. But I couldn't imagine it, you know. And then when we went in with this big orchestra and he had it all written out and they were looking at him like, who's this? He was only like 20 or something, you know. It was just, you know, all these like old grizzly old French cello players and string players that have done like stuff for generations, you know, 50 years or something. Just like, who's this young English upstart that thinks he knows what he's talking about, you know. And they were all chatting amongst themselves, and in the end Adam like got the thing, you know, the baton thing, and like twatted it on the on the lectern, and they went, shut up, you know, like, pay attention. And he was dead, like,
they all
crapped themselves and started paying attention. And then one of them was playing a wrong note. I think it was one of the oboes or something, he was telling me, and he was playing this wrong note. And he was like sort of complaining that, like, and Adam could speak French as well. That's the other thing. They were all talking about in French, and then he spoke in French. And they realised, wait a minute, the game's up here. He's not just some div from England. And this bloke was playing the wrong note, and Adam went over and said, "You're playing the wrong note." He said, "No, it's written." He said, "No, you're not. Look, it's right." And it was right. Adam was right, and the lad was wrong. Yeah, you know, and he's like, you know, an old pro kind of thing. Sure. So at the end, when it was all finished, they all stood up and clapped.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because, you know, they realised that when they were playing it, it sounded amazing. It really worked, you know, so...
So what did it feel like when you first went in and heard?
Well, I was in the studio with them.
Right. And it must have been amazing.
There was some carpets at the back, some old carpet. And I lay down on the carpet and was just like absorbing it, you know. Like, it was great.
Yeah, yeah.
So it was great. That studio, it was really good. They had this amazing reverb unit. It was dead big. It was like a great big wooden box. It's like, and they have like some sort of, they call it a slate reverb. I don't know how it works.
Right.
But it was a massive thing, and it made everything sound like Scott Walker or something. Yeah. You know, it was like a big warm reverb. It was amazing. And but we couldn't where we mixed it, they didn't have one of them reverbs. So we had to hire one in. And it wasn't quite as good. It's still great, but it wasn't as good as this old valve reverb thing they had.
So for me, Ocean Rain album, I mean, it will do for a lot of people, you know, particularly my age. You know, that was the album I was dragging into school, playing in the sixth form common room all the time.
Yeah.
You know, and you know, there was so much excitement about it. There was so much press about it as well. And you know, to pick a favourite track off it is pretty tricky, because you know, obviously you've got One About a Moon, haven't you?
Like a, you know, can only talk. You know, I'm talking about my guitar stuff because I'm the guitarist. But you know, the guitar on that is actually an acoustic guitar.
All right, okay.
And it was through, I've got it in there, in fact. It was through an old radio, a Blaupunkt radio, and it had like an input at the back.
Right.
And you could just, it wasn't like a plug hole, it was like two little things. And I used to stick the wires in with matchsticks.
Right. Okay. Like, so don't do that at home.
Well, it was like an input, you know, so you could put like a record player through it or
right,
something.
Okay.
This dead old valve Blaupunkt radio, German thing. I think it's the German. But when I put the acoustic through it, it just made that total fuzz sound.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was, we'd been given these electric acoustics from Washburn, who were like some company.
Yeah, yeah.
And they gave us all these acoustics. They gave Les an acoustic bass guitar as well, I think. So it was that, and it was like me going nuts on that thing, but it was through a radio.
Wow.
Through a
little
valve radio. I should have got it out, shouldn't I? It's in there somewhere. But it's behind a load of stuff. It'd take me ages.
So for you, what was your favourite track off it?
Oh God. Like, as a song, Killing Moon is the best one, but as an interesting,
you can say Killing Moon.
Yeah, I know, but you know, yeah, it probably is Killing Moon.
Okay,
because it stands out, doesn't it? And that was done in Bath. And when we were recording that, have you heard of Peter Hamill?
Yes.
Van de Graaff Generator.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, he turned up, and I remember him, sort of vaguely remember him coming. But he twittered me, you know, on that Twitter thing.
Yeah.
And he said, oh, you might not remember this, but I was there when you did Killing Moon. And he came, only for a light, he wasn't there all the time.
Yeah, yeah.
He came for like a little visit because he knew the producer, this bloke called David Lord, and he knew him. So he popped in the studio, and I remember us all thinking, who's this weirdo? Like, yeah. But Peter Hamill.
Yeah.
Like, a lot, you know, sort of getting into the Van de Graaff Generator stuff now. It took me a while to get used to it. But I like his voice. Really kind of like English.
Right.
And like authoritative. It's a weird kind of operatic almost voice, you know, but dead low and
so great. With the Killing Moon, to your right here, you've got the Vox.
Oh yeah,
which I'd say it's that, along with your Rickenbacker, probably, I don't know, maybe your Fender as well, your most iconic guitars.
Yeah, and like the other thing about Killing Moon was we didn't you know, put it through an amp.
Right.
Like, so I was playing it, and there's like a mic here and a mic here by this, so it was dead awkward to play.
Okay.
I remember I had to do it like this, and that's where it's kind of like sounds a bit sort of like staggery, but that sort of adds to its charm. So this is like a more authentic version, like, you know. what's you know, and we just put a bit of reverb on it, and that was it really. It was kind of, it wasn't through an amp or through loads of effects. It was just mic'd up, because it's an electric acoustic, and I think Dave Lutz had all would like the sound of that on its own, you know, when I was like just messing around, and so we did it, and I remember going into like a, I think it was like a vocal booth or something. I was dead like trying to be like not make any noises, you know, because when you move, you know, you make a noise, or your coat will make a noise or something. Yeah, so that was that really, and then we went for a curry.
A curry and bath.
Yeah.
So that sort of covers all the albums. Which, you know, fantastic. And
let's show you a couple more of these, which are dead important to me. There's this Nuggets. Like, it's hard to read, but it says Nuggets, and you know, it's got like electric prunes.
Why was that important?
What?
Why was that important?
Well, it's just like, you know, like in Eric's, they used to play like the odd sort of garage band thing, you know, like they play like, you know, the 13th floor elevators or whatever, or, you know, and that band, Wayne County and the Electric Chairs used to always come on to The Nighttime by The Strange, you know, the songs by The Strange Loves, but they used to come on to this thing.
Okay.
And it used to go on for ages, just the bass line pumping away, and it would build up the atmosphere. And all them sort of things, they stick with you, you know. So like, you know, all right, we don't do a bass thing that goes on for ages, but we'll do like, you know, we at one point we had bells, you know, like ringing of bells, and then we had like Gregorian chants.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah,
and
then, yeah.
And right early on, we used to have Brian Eno and John Hassell off an LP called Possible Munich Music of the Third World.
It was right. I don't know that one.
Third World Possible Music, something like that, and that was like the early Doors sort of intro, but it builds it all up, you know, and that's that was kind of came
so
from that a little bit.
With the you mentioned the Gregorian chants, where did they come from?
Well, it just made it more like a religious experience. We wanted it to be, you know, more than just a rock band. We always wanted it to be more than just a rock band, and more than just, you know, your normal rock band format.
Yeah.
It was just, you know, punk rock had kind of changed everything, everyone's perception of rock music and prog rock and all that stuff. So we were trying to go forward with something else.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And I had this cassette of the Gregorian chants, and I said, you know, used to choose what we used to go on to, you know, that sort of thing. So.
So you said Dave Bowie.
Yeah, that's Images. That's I got that in Virgin Records on Bold Street not long after they opened, 1973. So yeah.
Someone scribbled on the top right hand corner.
Know, like, I've got all my Bowie records signed.
By David Bowie.
Well, yeah. Not by somebody else.
Yeah,
but you know, that was this. I think this one's Mac's favourite, actually.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. It is. Yeah, it is an amazing album.
Yeah, it's great. And all these things, you go through periods where you think, "Oh, that's good," or you go off it, and then you come back to it, and it comes round and round, you know.
Yeah.
Like this is an old, you know, you need that one if you can find that. 13th floor elevators. That one and the other one, Easter Everywhere, which is another album by him.
Right.
Are we done, Pete?
I think we're done.
We have a cup of tea now.
Have a cup of tea. Go and say hello to the dogs.
Oh, yeah.
And thank you very much, everybody, for tuning in. Make sure you leave some comments underneath.
There's been loads of comments.
Yeah. But
you know what?
It's too far away.
You know what I'm worried about? That they can't hear us.
Yeah, they're probably all saying can't hear you.
Yeah, they will be.
Yeah, so we'll have to do it again.
Because it's quite a way away, isn't it?
It is.
But I'm trying to be loud. Can you hear it all right?
Can you hear me, Mother?
Roger Kirby says, that was ace.
Melissa Poole, Rocky. Don't know what that means. Ian Mills, Can't Hear You. Oh, we're in shit.
Oh, bloody hell. Right, well, thank you very much. And goodbye. The finger is going to press the stop. Goodbye, goodbye, goodbye.